To the third of our talks on sustainability here at UCI. I just want to remind you that the next two talks, that's next Tuesday and Tuesday afterwards, will not take place here, but will take place in the Humanities Building. And if you go into our website, cusa.uci.edu, you'll find full information about where the talk is and how to get there. But the next two talks are going to take place in the Humanities Building auditorium. Tonight's talk is on the topic of ethics and sustainability. And I want to start off by giving you a little bit of an overview of what I'm going to cover in the next hour. I'm going to start off by talking about what we mean by ethics, and then because people don't get a lot of instruction in ethics, although we think of ourselves as a fairly ethical society, we don't learn about it very much. So I'm going to do a very quick history of ethics in the Western tradition. And from that, I'll move on to the topic of environmental ethics and then conclude with some comments about the relationship between ethics and sustainability. When we talk about ethics, we're talking about moral philosophy, or I'm talking about moral philosophy. And let me tell you, to begin with, that the terms ethics, morality, justice, they're not very precise. People use them in different ways. But what I'm talking about here is our understanding of what is good versus bad, what is right, what is wrong, what is fair, what is just, what is virtuous behavior. And historically, we've grappled with these questions in three ways. We've asked, where do our understandings of what is fair or what is good come from? We've asked, how do we take these understandings and apply them to situations in the real world, situations that are sometimes very complicated and uncertain. And thirdly, we ask, why should we bother doing all this? What's the point of doing this? Why do we want to be ethical? Do we want to be ethical? Apparently, according to a lot of survey information, America does want to be ethical. America sees itself as an ethical society, as a morally grounded society, as a leader on moral issues. And we've done so since our founding. The center I direct does an annual survey, and what we've discovered in this annual survey is that after 9/11, after the economic crisis, it doesn't matter what sort of calamity we experience, Americans overwhelmingly see people as good, they see themselves as good, they believe in doing good. And no matter what proxy we use, and religion is a common one, this is from a Gallup poll, so it's a fairly good poll. No matter what proxy we use for moral behavior, ethical behavior, we discovered the overwhelming majority of Americans say this is an important part of their lives. Being moral is important. This is, in fact, more than 3/4 of Americans claim that a determinant of how they vote in any election is the moral character of the candidates. We believe that it's important to be moral in public life. We believe it's important to be ethical in private life. We don't, however, believe by an overwhelming majority that we do this. If we look at the most recent polls, the most recent Gallup polls on ethics in America, over 80% of Americans would rate our country's state of moral values as poor or fair. And this number has remained fairly constant over the past decade. If we look at the direction in which people think we're going, again, the overwhelming majority feel that things are getting worse. So we believe in ethics. We believe that people are good. We believe that we should do good. We believe it's important to us, and we make decisions on this basis. But for some reason, we see a great gap between what we're doing and what our country is doing, what the other people in our country are doing. In fact, never before have our evaluations of political leaders and business leaders been as low as they are today. We see these people as morally ungrounded. We see them as making almost all of their decisions on the basis of personal gain. We see them looking for profit opportunities in everything they do. And Gallup poll after Gallup poll and many other polls confirm this. We believe in ethics, but we don't believe that our country acts ethically. And we certainly don't believe our business leaders or our politicians do. Now, why is that? Why are we so pessimistic? How do we explain this big gap between what the world we believe in and the world we think we're living in. There's lots of ways one could approach it, but here are a couple of reasons that have been discussed that have received a considerable amount of attention in recent years. And one is that our world has become a very, very fast-paced, complicated place. And in this very, very complicated, fast-paced place, we find ourselves facing a lot of challenges that are epic in scale. What does it mean? What is a moral position on reproductive cloning or stem cell research? What are the moral implications of global warming or biodiversity loss, of species disappearing? These are huge questions, and we sense that what we do or don't do has a transformative capacity. Our world is changing, and it matters what we do, but we're not entirely sure what to do. When we look in the past, we don't see clear guidelines. Nobody wrote guidance notes on these issues 50 or 100 years ago that we can turn to and say, when they faced the question of reproductive cloning, here's how they dealt with it. And we're worried that, in any case, a lot of things are out of our control. We're not sure if we make this decision, will it have the consequences that we want it to have? We see a lot of effects as nonlinear these days. And all of these issues are challenging our ability to orient ourselves morally in a way in which we're confident. There's another layer of complication. We are much more complicated people as individuals than was ever the case in the past. Today, because of technology, very few people grow up in a small community, interact with that community more or less their entire lives, rarely leave that community, have one role, one major economic role that they play for their entire lives. Today, people will live here for a few months, over there for a couple of years, over here for a few years. They'll move from one job to another job to a third job during the course of their lifetime. They'll live a long time, they'll be in many relationships with many communities. And it's not always easy to reconcile their moral obligations as a community member, a place that they've lived for maybe 6 months or a year, here, versus as a father, versus as a professor, versus as a consumer, versus as an environmentalist. There's a lot going on. And the easiest thing, of course, the path of least resistance is to sort of just allow the status quo to reproduce itself. Or to do the things that for which there are big incentives, like consume. Big incentives to watch TV, big incentives to buy stuff. And that's sort of an easy thing to do, and so a lot of us spend a lot of time buying stuff and watching TV. The result, according to Curtis White, fairly controversial figure, is we have now a society sort of that sees itself as very moral, but is actually fairly mediocre in terms of when it comes to morality. A society that has much bigger aspirations than its practices seem to deserve or warrant. Is that true? I'm not sure if it's true. One thing I am sure about is that we've spent an awful long time, 25 centuries at least, trying to figure out the issue of ethics. I'm going to talk about it from principally a Western perspective, just because of time constraints. And in many ways, the Western debates are quite unique, and they're certainly influential in our lives, in the lives that we're living here. So let me give you a quick, brief history of ethical thinking. You may recognize this painting. A lot of art historians would call this one of the highlights of the Renaissance. Raphael painted it in 1509, 1510 for the Apostolic Church of the Vatican. And it's called the Greek School. Up there in the, it's very hard, I'll point out, Socrates in the brown, the two central figures, the one in red and a sort of clear colored long beard, Plato beside him, more youthful, brown hair, earth tones and sky and water tones, Aristotle, lounging on the front stairs, Diogenes, to his right, Pythagoras. We're not sure who most of the figures are. We know, we have pretty good ideas of many of them, but we don't have photographs, so it was very hard to figure out who the artist intended to be who. But we do know that the idea was to capture the richness of philosophy. This was one of four frescoes painted for the church, and the focus of this one was philosophy. It was wisdom. It was about ethical discourse. And things start in our tradition largely with Socrates and Plato, because Plato was the person who made the argument that life is about ethics. Life is about justice. Politics is rightly about applied ethics, about creating conditions in which people will do the right thing, the good thing, the just thing. Plato argued, one of his most famous arguments was that what's your most trusted source for ethical discourse? It's philosophy. He said religious people may tell you that you should do this or you should do that, and they may or may not be right, but they can't prove it to you, and you have no way of knowing whether they've interpreted things correctly. So philosophers alone lead you step by step through their reasoning, and they say, this is what you should do, and here are the reasons, and you can challenge them at any point. You can say, I don't agree with that because of this, this, and that. He said, philosophers ultimately are your most trusted source for ethical discussion. Therefore, countries, states should be led by philosophers. Philosophers should rule the world. They're the ones who understand what a just society should look like. And it turns out what a just society should look like is a society in which people do what they are best suited to do. Some people rule because they're best suited to rule. Other people produce because they're best suited to produce. Some people guard because they're best suited to guard. In the Republic of Plato, Plato's discussion of this, he's challenged by a cynic, Thrasymachus, who says, you know what? He said, I'll tell you what ethics is. Ethics is about people who are rich and powerful saying, this is what you should do. And they do it for one reason, to stay rich and powerful. And if the weak agree with that, say, okay, you want me to do this, you want me to obey, you want me to hand over some of my money, then they're just stupid. And for the past 2,500 years, people have debated, is ethics just sort of the rich and powerful, constructing a world which keeps them in place, or is it something more than that? Is it something that is objective, something that we can all determine in some way or another? What is ethics really about? Plato's most famous student, and here you have an interesting picture, Plato on your left, with his finger pointing to the air and colors of fire and air. People think about him having this philosophical posture. Aristotle in earth colors and water colors, more grounded, pointing at people, the empiricist. Aristotle was uncomfortable with the idea of a sort of strict society that a philosopher would design, in which each of us was assigned a specific role. In Plato's world, we had no children because children create effective bonds with parents, parents create effective bonds with children, and this sort of leads people to do things which aren't good and right. So all children would be raised communally in his world. And those who were smart would do this, and those who were fast would do this, and those who were good with music would do that. But there'd be no favoritism in that world. Aristotle said, this is not really what humans are about. Humans are about things like friendship. He decided that what we're really about as people is happiness, or well-being, eudaimonia. And a way to achieve a state of well-being, of happiness, was to live a virtuous life, a good life, an ethical life. And it wasn't always clear what that was. So we had to learn through experience. We had to learn through observation. We had to learn through discussion. And the goal was, he said, we have a general sense of what it is. It means to be courageous. It means to be wise. It means to be fair. It means to be altruistic. It means to be temperate. Those are virtues. But he said exactly what it requires us to do is not clear. He gave us one indicator. He said, somewhere between extremes is the sweet spot of ethical behavior. Between recklessness and cowardice is courage. And we're trying to find those sweet spots, and we're trying to live in accordance with them. Now, a lot of people said that this sort of set the platform for our thinking about ethics. Here we had the cynics, we had the people who thought it was sort of about society and roles in society, and people thought it was sort of about virtue and cultivating our own virtuous characters. Over time, lots of people respond to us. The Stoics would argue that somewhere inscribed in nature is a set of laws which are universal, and if we can access them, we'll know what's good and what's right and what's just. And they're written perhaps by God. And they're accessible to everybody if they know how to find them. Epicureans focused on moderation. A good person is the person who's moderate in all things. A radical sea shift came when Christianity displaced antiquity, a movement that began around the beginning of the 5th century and was completed sometime around the year 800 when Charlemagne was crowned as a Christian, as leader of Christianity. Christianity took us in a very different direction, or at least it began to take us in a very different direction. And the early Christians said, what is the good life? What is the moral life? It's a life of withdrawal, of disengagement. Autoexusia, a life of self-rule. The most virtuous person was the person who disengaged from everything, who didn't need to consume, didn't need relationships, but instead focused on his or her personal relationship with something greater, something bigger, with God. Many early Christians moved into the desert. They distanced themselves from people. They started to attach tremendous value to things like celibacy, to abstinence. The New Testament, there were three important books that sort of define moral thinking for about 1,000 years in Western history, from about 200 to about 1200. The first was the New Testament, and its simple message probably, it's a huge book with lots of complexity and nuance, but one of its simple messages that everybody apprehends is the notion of reciprocity. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And many people feel that is the core of our ethical understanding. We do things that we would expect other people, we treat people the way we would like to be treated. And that is the core of what moral behavior is. A second important and influential work was St. Benedict's Rules, in which he stressed the importance of obedience. The ethical life was a life of obedience. A life where you did what you were told by somebody who was in a position to tell you what was good and right. The abbot of the monastery, your priest. But perhaps the most dramatic departure from classical thinking was written by St. Augustine in City of God. We tried to understand how could Rome, this eternal city, which once had a million inhabitants, which brought wealth from the surrounding countryside for miles and miles into the surrounding countryside. It brought in slaves and it brought in food, it brought in water, it brought gold. It built incredibly, incredibly beautiful and complicated architectural infrastructure. Water conduits and roads, the Colosseum. How could it have collapsed so dramatically under the pressure of the barbarian invaders? And he decided the real answer was that we lived in a state of sin. We lived in a state of sin. People were sinful. And he developed a notion of two worlds. One, the world that we're living in, where people are imperfect and sinful. And the other one, which he called the second life, eternal life, which if we were lucky, we would get where people were perfect. He said, life is punishment. Life is a punishment. It's a punishment for disobedience. We disobeyed God, we were punished for it. Kicked out of Eden and subjected to hunger, to disease, to lust, to growing old, to being tired, to having to work. So life was largely about sin. To talk about ethics, morality, and justice in this world for St. Augustine was a bit of a stretch. A bit of a stretch, because we couldn't have it here. we'd already lost that. This was a smart choice for Christianity, it turned out, because he basically said to the rulers who were not Christian, we don't care what you do. We do not care what you do. Rule how you want. Take our money. Do what you want. We don't care. Just leave our churches alone so that we can educate people. So that we can, and what we'll give you in return for peace is obedient subjects. Now, as we know what happened, the rulers looked at the deal and said, that's not a bad deal. You'll let us collect taxes, you'll let us rule, and all we have to do is leave your churches unmolested. Over the course of the next few hundred years, churches sprung up all through Europe, through Northern Africa, into the UK. And all of a sudden, one day, the churches stopped obeying secular authorities. They had become so powerful. Nobody knows if St. Augustine had a master plan, if he saw this as a way to displace secular authority, but it worked that way in the end. In the Middle Ages, the late Middle Ages, the end of the Middle Ages, when the church had reached its peak, people began to look at it and said, where is this austerity? Where is this celibacy? Where is this disengagement from lust and sin, from theft? People like Marcellus of Padua began to see the church as a very powerful entity which was acting a lot like the secular rulers that it displaced. And so he said, you know what? St. Augustine got it right the first time around. Morality and ethics are about the world here, the world up there, not about the world down here. In fact, the church has no authority in the world down here. He said, the world down here is about something else. It's about commerce, it's about security. It's about building houses. It's about farming. You can have morality and ethics, but it has nothing to do with secular rule. He began to separate what we now think of as church and state. And in the early Renaissance, Machiavelli, Italian statesman from Florence, took this and said, this is exactly right. Social life, political life isn't about ethics. There's very little to do with ethics. It's not about virtue, at least not in the sense of, not in that Christian sense, not in that classical Greek sense. It's about power. Thrasymachus was right. St. Augustine was right. It's about power. It's about getting power, holding on to power. That's what life is about. And you're either in charge, driving the cart, or you're enslaved and you're pulling the cart. Those are the options that we have. Now, Machiavelli was a pretty complicated thinker. And a lot of people have read The Prince and the Discourses and said, actually, when you read them carefully, he was looking at these tough guys, condottieri, people who were taking over Venice, taking over Florence, and he was saying to them, yeah, I understand you. It's all about power. It's all about rule. It's all about running things. It's all about extracting wealth from people. It's all about enlarging your domains. It's all about having your way. That's what life is really and truly about. And people who adopt a Christian attitude, they're weak. They're easy prey. They're the ones to plunder. They'll turn the other cheek. They're fools. The good things in life go to the people who have the courage to grab them, to take them. And then he said, but if you want to stay in power, you've got to supplement your strong arm tactics with good laws. It's easier in the long run. It's easier in the long run if you let your subjects have their property, have their wives, have their farms, unmolested, untouched. They'll be easier to rule. And a lot of people think that what he was trying to do was to introduce ethics in the back door. We don't know for sure what his goal was. We do know he was only the beginning of a long trajectory. I wonder whether moral life was even possible. Thomas Hobbes said, you know what morality really is? Morality, for me, is what I want, what gives me pleasure. And for you, it's what you want, what gives you pleasure. That's what morality is. There's nothing objective up there. He said, if there was, people would have figured it out. They've been arguing about it for 2,000 years. They've been debating what's good and what's right and what's just for 2,000 years, and nobody has come to a complete agreement. And the reason is because there isn't any answer. There's no answer to that question. Yes, we had this long, fancy debate going back centuries. We've had it because they're asking a question that cannot be answered. We share one thing in common. None of us want to die a premature, violent death. That's where we start. That's the starting point of building a strong society, is to assume that none of us want to die a premature, violent death. Life is about security. That's what it's about. And if you get it, and if you live in a society that allows you to live more years rather than less years, and that's a success. That's a success story. You should be happy with it. And it shouldn't matter to you what the leaders claim to be ethical behavior, as long as you can live as many years as possible. Now, Pufendorf and Locke began to challenge them. They said, this can't be all life's about. It can't just be about the strong, the powerful, getting your way. Is that all life is really about? Do all the good things just go to the greedy, the grasping, the strategic? Or do only fools turn the other cheek? Only fools altruistic? Pufendorf and Locke began to argue, no, there's got to be something more than that. To be human is somehow to be moral. There's a natural law out there. And that natural law, and this was the radical move, that natural law is accessible to everyone. And what it really does is it gives all of us the capacity to challenge those rulers, to challenge those leaders, to challenge kings, to challenge popes, to challenge anyone who says we ought to obey them because they're the king, they're the pope, they're whoever, they're the ones with the inside knowledge of what is right and what is good and what is just. Locke said everyone has that. We all know what is right and what is good and what is just, and that gives us not just the capacity to challenge authority, but it gives us the obligation to challenge authority when it misbehaves. Now, this was an inspiring and also dangerous doctrine. It was a doctrine which ultimately would be picked up by the United States and used as a foundation for the constitution of our country, the right to revolution. This notion that you could challenge authority, and you could challenge it on moral grounds. You could say to people, you are not behaving morally, you have no right to rule our country. And you could rise up against them, unseat them, and put somebody else in place. Rousseau agreed that life was largely about morality. He said, and interestingly enough, these days many scientists have worked to confirm Rousseau's notion that we are by nature compassionate. And we have a level of understanding which is qualitatively different than any other species. And it's that combination of understanding and compassion which gives us the ability to be moral beings. Unfortunately, according to Rousseau, we've made such bad decisions that we would probably never find our way back to a moral lifestyle. Kant also agreed life ultimately is about being moral. And he said, this isn't such a mystery. We can figure out what we need to do. We should ask ourselves some simple questions. Would we accept our behavior to be turned into a law? And ourselves subject to it? Are we thinking of people as ends rather than as means to get something? Would our behavior fit into a world in which there are multiple ends? He said, if you can answer those questions, then you're on the track, you're on the right track to moral behavior. Kant, Bentham said, let's recover ourselves notion of happiness. Eudaimonia. Moral behavior is behavior which creates the largest amount of happiness for the most people in a society. That's how we measure it. Over the past couple of centuries, there's been lots and lots of takes, but they use the same vocabulary. Cynical views, There's no such thing as moral life, there's no such thing as ethical behavior. It's for the weak, it's for the foolish, it's for the people who are going to be on the losing end of every stick, of every battle, of every confrontation. Life is a lonely place. All the way to people who make the argument that moral behavior is natural, it's normal, it's right, it's what humans do, it's what distinguishes us from other species, our capacity to care about others, to be altruistic. In the 20th century, the last century, there have been lots and lots of animated debates between people trying to figure out, does ethics matter at all? Is it all a word game? Is it all a mask for what are really sort of ruthless people getting their way in society, making themselves rich and powerful at the expense of all those dummies who obey the rules? Is that really the best way to understand life, that you're either a dummy obeying the rules or you're a rich and powerful person disregarding them? Is it something that defines the character of the communities we live in? How we allocate everything from education to healthcare? Is it something very individual? We have to figure out of ourselves what moral life requires us to do. There's been lots of interesting developments in the past 30 or 40 years, as we've come into greater contact with other cultures and tried to figure out, is moral behavior in one culture as authentic and right as it is in another culture? Are they basically saying the same thing? If they seem to be saying something radically different, can one trump the other? We've probed the issue of gender and asked, does it matter? Are there differences between men and women that are morally significant? And we've introduced the question of the natural environment. What I want you to take out of this are just a few key terms that define the whole discussion of ethics. Key terms. Is ethics deontological? Is it about rules? Thou shalt not kill. That's the rule. Doesn't matter what the conditions are. That's the rule. And moral behavior requires you to obey the rule. Is it about consequences? Is it thou shalt not kill unless killing saves a whole lot of lives, protects your family? Or is it about personal character and virtue? Are you aspiring to be a particular type of person? Is that what moral life is all about? Is it driven by the individual? Is it driven by the community? Where, ultimately, do our moral intuitions and values come from? Do we figure them out through deliberation? Do they come from God? Are they inscribed in some holy text or in nature? Artifacts of cultural production, or is it just a veil for raw power relationships? Is it just a language which takes the edge off the fact that life is largely about coercion, that life is largely, from any perspective, unfair? It's about haves and have-nots, powerful and weak, rich and poor. However we understand ethics, how do we apply it to real-world situations? Let's say we say that we believe that something should be allocated, jobs should be allocated on the basis of merit. You should get a job because you deserve it. Somebody interviews a group of people, and they say, well, I'm giving it to this person because she is the best looking. Is that fair? She might say, you know why I'm the best looking? Because personal hygiene, I watch my diet, I work out all the time. I have a consultant who advises me on how to dress. I deserve this job. What we discover is that simple things like merit are hard to fully understand and look at. They're not self-evident always. And finally, what's our motivation? Do we obey? Do we think we should be ethical because we're afraid the consequences of not being ethical? Do we think we'll be happier or somehow more fulfilled if we are? Or as some scientists today argue, is it really a survival mechanism honed by evolution? It's a smart strategy to be ethical, to care about other people. This is the background for discussions of environmental ethics which have taken shape over the past 30 or 40 years. You may be familiar with Thoreau and his famous book where he talks about going into disengaging from society and going into nature. And in the 19th century, sometime in the 19th century, a whole lot of forces converged to amplify the interest many people had in nature. There were tales about exotic lands that had been becoming more and more authentic for a couple of hundred years as the world was explored. People probing further into uncharted territories. There was the belief that if we could contemplate nature, we could understand the mind of God. There was a sense that nature was renewal. If we moved into nature, we got out of the dirty city, the bleak city, the polluted city. And there was something valuable about standing there with just the sky above us, no people. It was a transcendent moment. Surrounded by trees, big, powerful things, the powerful forces that put everything into perspective, that helped us make sense of the world we were involved in. There's also a growing concern for how people treated animals. It's interesting. French historian Robert Darden writes wrote a book, The Great Cat Massacre, in which he described how in the Middle Ages, one of the things many towns did because they had problems with cats and other vermin, was they would have these festivals where they would creatively kill as many as possible. They would chop off their legs and chop off their heads. They would skin them alive. They'd throw them into boiling water. They'd toss them into fires. The whole town would go crazy killing cats, rounding cats up and killing them. They would do everything imaginable to get rid of all these cats. They suggested nobody thought for a second that this was cruel. This was funny. It was a break from day-to-day life. Let's round up a whole bunch of cats and do horrifying things to them for the next 2 or 3 days. Because cats don't have feelings, cats don't have memories. Slowly, for a variety of reasons, probably largely due to scientific studies of animals, people began to say, maybe there's a little more there. And so we start to see movements to prevent cruelty to animals. All these things converge, and they converge into what we now call environmental ethics. Environmental ethics, I should tell you at the outset, is not a field which is universally applauded. In fact, it's actually a field that has invited a lot of hostility. A lot of people around the world see it as very elitist. Who cares about the environment? This is rich kids who want to preserve wilderness. That's what environmental ethics is all about. Rich kids who have the time to go out to Yosemite with Joshua Tree, with their Gore-Tex rain gear and their SUVs. Has nothing to do with the real world. It's a neo-colonial attitude. It's an American attitude. It's the U.S., it's Canada, it's Australia, trying to protect big areas of our land in Africa or Asia. Land we can't afford to put aside and protect because we have a lot of people who are poor and hungry. It's just another wave of colonialism trying to force us to protect areas and keep people out of them. People think of the famous stories of Richard Leakey going to Africa to protect megafauna and hiring guards to keep the poor local people out of his area, an expanding area that got bigger and bigger as he struggled to protect, with the support of environmentalists in North America, elephants and zebras. Protect them from what? From the people who lived there for millennia. It's culturally insensitive, people parading up in their Gore-Tex gear to stop Inuit from their annual seal hunt, something that's gone on for hundreds, thousands of years, something they don't understand. It's uninformed. People just asserting GMOs are bad for you without any real scientific basis for making that assertion. It fails to appreciate how special people are. We are a special species. We we do something that no other species does, we produce culture. We have produced the great Gothic cathedrals, the great mosques, the great temples, the great buildings, the great painting, the great music. That's what people do. And nature is part of our means of doing this. And there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with a focus on human culture. It's incoherent and patronizing. What does it mean to assign animals rights? What does it mean to talk about animals' rights? Are they deliberating? Are they in agreement with us? Or is it just some hopeless act of arrogance to say, these animals have these rights? It's offensive. Peter Singer, the famous philosopher, has argued, well, the taboos on sexual behavior are slowly eroding. Bit by bit, we're allowing a larger and larger terrain of sexual behavior. What is this artificial border between one species and the next? For genetically similar to monkeys and other animals, what's the taboo? Why shouldn't we push past that one as well? A lot of people, of course, have found his famous article, Heavy Petting, to be deeply offensive. Well, as people say, the whole thing is superfluous anyways. We've already figured out that we shouldn't be cruel to animals. We already know that. We don't need a special branch of ethics to instruct us in these things. But there may be something here, and I want to quickly review what it might be. There's sort of two general approaches to environmental ethics. One that looks at it from a human perspective, in which we are the key players in the world, and makes the argument that thinking about adding nature into our moral deliberation is a prudent thing to do, it's an enlightened thing to do. And then there's a biocentric set of approaches, which say, look, we are part of the great web of life. We are part of something much bigger than ourselves. This web of life goes back billions of years, 3.8 billion years, and it will continue long after we are gone. We're just one of millions, hundreds of millions of species that have been on this earth. We've got to put ourselves into a much broader perspective, a perspective that you do get when you walk out into the desert, when you're hiking Yosemite, when you look at the splendor of nature, when you see what's available out there. And when we understand that, we'll start to realize that things have value that we can't appreciate. They have what's called intrinsic value. And the system fits together, the world fits together in ways which we are only beginning to touch upon. It's amazing that we create this, that this world has been created, that life took shape, that it's evolved. We've got to put ourselves in perspective here. Those mosques and those churches, those Gothic cathedrals are wonderful. But take a look at nature before we start claiming that our cultural productions are the most impressive things. Now, there's a whole lot of perspectives, a multiplicity of perspectives, and I'm going to just touch upon a couple of them to give you a sense. I'm going to start with some of the anthropocentric ones. This famous image of tulip fields, striking. Gerhard Hardin argued that what we need to do to protect nature is turn it into private property. That was the good and right thing to do. We need to privatize nature. Because if we don't, if we cling to this belief, this old belief, that nature is something bigger than ourselves, that it should be accessible to everybody. And what happens is nobody has an incentive to protect it. We call this the tragedy of the commons, and he said, look what's happening. Look what's happening to the oceans. Nobody owns them, so they're being overfished, they're being dumped in, they're being destroyed. If we want to protect the oceans, privatize them. Remember John Locke, chapter 5 of the Second Treatise of Government. On property. How do we acquire property? We mix our labor with nature. It's the good thing to do, it's the right thing to do. It's not only God's injunction, be fruitful and multiply, which Locke interpreted as go out there and work nature, turn it into something of greater value. But according to Garrett Hardin, it was the right solution to our environmental woes. Privatize nature and stop reproducing. If you want to know what is good and just from the perspective of that world out there, that world of trees and rocks and flowers, it was fairly simple. Slow down population growth and privatize things. Other people focused on what were we leaving to future generations. I'm sure you're all familiar with the definition of sustainable development. Satisfying the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to satisfy their own needs. Some people focused on the aesthetic value of nature. We should preserve it because it's beautiful. Or we should preserve it because we don't fully understand it yet. It may have the cure to cancer, as a famous example. Somewhere out there are medical therapies which we have never discovered. And if we destroy things, if we transform them too quickly into suburbs and malls and roads, we lose beauty and we lose value. We need to preserve nature. Our what is good and right to do is to protect nature. It's valuable to us. Some people say, if we look at all the world's religions, look at Christianity, for example, there's St. Francis of Assisi, who discovered that there's an injunction there to preserve nature. It is the creation of something divine. And as St. Francis was famous for thinking, nothing God created could be bad or can be improved upon. So we should be very, very modest and humble in going out there and changing everything around. We should protect this magnificent creation. Social ecology. And this is a different social ecology than we might have here at the university. But social ecology is famous for the idea that really, environmental ethics, questions about our relationship to the natural world, about what is good and right to do, to nature, to the ocean, to the forests. It's only a problem because our social relationships are so immoral and unjust. We've got to drill down in the other direction, stop exploiting people because of gender or ethnicity, culture. And when we start getting our own act in order, we'll discover that it becomes much harder to exploit the nature on which we all depend. Ecofeminism have attacked the tendency in the Western tradition to simplify the world into a set of dualisms, reason versus emotion, nature versus civilization, and to imply that one of them is superior to the other, a reason superior to emotion. Plato's argument. Civilization is superior to nature, Locke's argument. They ask us not to simplify this world, the world in this way, but instead, to look at the continuities and differences across things that we don't fully understand. To harbor some sort of ontological reverence for difference, for a principle of difference. To appreciate continuities across differences, but also to have reverence for things that are different. Biocentric perspectives are much more aggressive. They say, throw out all that way of thinking, get rid of it, move beyond it. It's largely responsible for the dilemma that we find ourselves in today. Our world is a mess. And if we think we can solve it by tinkering with a philosophy that has allowed us to destroy it for 2,500 years, we're wrong. We need to reorient ourselves in a much more dramatic way. One of the most famous examples of this was Aldo Leopold's land ethic. Composed 60 years ago, it argued that we need to think of ourselves as part of this community, a bigger community, a community we need to understand by through science. And what was good and right was to do the things that would make this broader community include not just us, but also the forests and the grasslands and the marine areas, the oceans, that would make this larger community healthy and flourishing. Things that we did that would lead to the flourishing of this broader community in which we depended on were good, they were right, they were just. Things that diminished this ability to flourish and be healthy were wrong. And for Leopold, the key was science. Science would help us understand what was good and what was right to do. Science would help us understand how to be moral beings. Because science was our entry point into nature. Peter Singer, building on Jeremy Bentham, the utilitarian thinker, said, I don't care whether animals can think, I don't care if they have memories, I don't care if they can deliberate, I don't care if they can talk, the only thing I care about is can they suffer. And I look at an animal, if it's being beaten, I say that animal can suffer, therefore it's wrong. It's wrong to beat it. Peter Singer takes this argument much further. He says to us, listen. Somebody's in a coma. A coma they're not likely ever to recover from. They can't reciprocate, they can't communicate, they can't deliberate. They can't do things that are altruistic. Probably can't feel. Can we do anything we want to them? Can we do anything we want to that body? He says we can't. We know we can't. We may not be able to fully articulate why we can't, but we know it's wrong. He said, animals are much the same. They may not be able to communicate, they may not be able to deliberate, but we can't do anything we want to them. They have some intrinsic value. They have a telos, a purpose. We don't understand it very well. We should leave them alone. We should give them their autonomy. We should let them be what they are by nature supposed to be. To grow up to be animals, romping through the woods, doing animal things. And that means that we need to think very carefully about agriculture and scientific experiments and so on and so forth. Deep ecologists take us even further. This is our next, the famous Norwegian, married to Diana Ross of the Supremes. Not an elf. Possibly Norway's most famous person. Certainly one of the most widely cited thinkers. And what he wanted to argue is that society has distanced us from nature. We've got all these technologies that mediate between us and nature. We don't know where our food comes from. We don't know where our energy comes from. We don't understand that we don't have to live according to night and day. We've got the weather under control because our cars and our homes can be air conditioned and heated. We've lost all touch with nature. And guess what? We're unhappy, we're stressed out, we're tired all the time, we're lonely, we're a mess. We're unhappy people and we've lost touch with nature, and those two things are related. Those two things are related. We need to put our lives back into some sort of synchronization with this larger world around us, this world that we've tried to disengage from as completely as possible. Turn off the air conditioning. Stop being afraid of a little bit of heat or a little bit of cold, a little bit of rain, a little bit of snow. Start to understand the rhythms of nature. And as we do that, we'd get better sleep. We'd eat better. We'd understand things better. We'd understand the implications of eating this or doing that. Because we would see it in this grand sense, we'd see it in this sense of this incredible thing that functions in a whole lot of amazing ways around us, day after day, to support us, which we have turned our backs upon. So what he says is we've got to plug back into those rhythms, those processes. We've got to understand them. We have to strive for a biocentric identity. Not an idea that's disengaged from nature, but one that is fully engaged with nature. And he called this, he philosophy. You may have heard of Fritz Kappa's notion of eco-literacy. He said, we will not be happy. We will not solve our dilemmas of stress and fatigue and the sense of a meaningless life as we purchase one more commodity, as we watch one more hour of TV. I think I've said this. For these great guys, nobody sits on their deathbed. Nobody sits there at the age of 85 or 90, looking back at their life and saying, I wish I'd been a little more disengaged. I wish I'd watched a little more TV. Wish I'd had a little more fast food. Wish I'd bought a few more things at Walmart. When we examine our lives, those are not going to be, all those are the things that, that we spend our time on. Those are not going to be the things we look back on and wish we had done more of. We may wish we had spent more time hiking, more time with family, more time with friends, more time playing music, more time finding God, more time doing a whole lot of things. But we're not going to wish we had spent more time at the mall, more time watching reruns of our favorite TV show. At least that's what these guys think. Gaia theory, James Lovelock, wants to argue that Earth, we should think of Earth as an organism, as a living thing that regulates itself, that makes life possible. All of these notions, the anthropocentric ones, the biocentric ones, they're all a response to this growing, mounting concern that we are destroying the natural environment. Day by day, we are putting more and more intense pressure on the natural environment. Our behavior is not sustainable. You have seen in earlier lectures, people arguing, our problems are this big, our solution set is this small. We play around at the edges. We play around at the edges, carrying around cups so that we can fill them with coffee. But we don't attack the meat of the thing. The big issues which we need to attack to reduce the pace of global warming, biodiversity loss, and so on. And what all these people have suggested is that this destruction of the environment is a moral dilemma, it's a moral challenge, it's a moral problem for us. It may be a moral problem because we have, over centuries, created a false division between ourselves and the rest of nature, or it may be because the harm that we're doing to nature is made possible because nature has become a convenient medium for exploiting people, especially people in the future. We can take actions now which impose penalties in 20, 30, 50, 100 years, and we don't have to pay the costs. We can move polluting factories into the weakest parts of the world, into the weakest civilizations. We can take away their water, we can take away their forest cover. They can't do anything to us. All we know is we have nice furniture and nice clothes and good food, and we don't have to see the costs. We found very convenient ways to shelter ourselves from the costs of our behavior. We displace it onto the poor and the weak, the distant, the remote. We project it into the future. And we don't have to worry about it. Now, however you look at it, you'll be familiar with this, however you look at it, all of these different perspectives, these different ideas are telling us that to have a sustainable world, we need to think about our relationship to nature. Either from an environmental perspective, as something that's morally considerable, or from a human perspective, as a medium we use to exploit and harm other people. We need to think of these things and we need to correct them, and if we don't, then we cannot really talk about sustainability. Now, I said at the beginning of this lecture that, you know, here we are, a country which prides itself on our deep belief that people are good and that we're good, on our deep commitment to doing what is good and right and just. And yet we have the sense that this isn't the world that we live in anymore, that our world is not doing the things that are good and right and just. there's this huge gap between the world we live in, the world we see ourselves living in, and the world we claim to believe in. And no doubt the complexity of our problems. Who can fully understand the implications of, if somebody says to you, you can't allow stem cell research because stem cell research immediately leads to reproductive cloning, and reproductive cloning would be horrible. Are they right? Who knows whether that argument is persuasive or not? These are complicated things to understand. We have massive debates in our country about virtual images on the internet. And what sort of status do we give them? We're not sure, is it right or wrong to use performance-enhancing things? What would be wrong with it? If it gives you an edge at the Olympics, what's wrong with performance-enhancing drugs? We're not quite sure how to answer all these questions. We sense that they're big and they're complicated. Some people, of course, feel they've got them all figured out, but a lot of people are not sure about them. The natural environment, however, might just give us a platform to lead moral lives. It might be a basis for a type of renewal, for closing the circle between the world we live in and the world we believe we should be living in. You may be familiar with Pareto's 80-20 rule. He makes this argument, which has been widely validated in many fields, that 80% of the effects can be linked to 20% of the causes. In other words, if this is the realm of behavior up there, change 20% of it, and you'll get 80% of the outcome you want. We know that there are serious environmental problems. And what Pareto's rule says is, if we do what's good and right, on the 20% that we can agree on, where we have real leverage because we have unity, because we see things the same way, we don't have to worry about the 80%, where we disagree and where there's uncertainty and so on. Because if we commit ourselves to that area where we feel we're on solid ground, we will get 80% of the effect we want. And it's probably true. It's probably true. And in that sense, it doesn't really matter whether we act to protect nature, to preserve nature, to develop a sustainable relationship with nature, because we think this is good from a spiritual or type of perspective, whether we see ourselves belonging to something bigger than just human society, whether we believe that the parts out there, the snow leopards and the algae, have intrinsic value, have telos, a purpose, and deserve to be left alone to the greatest extent possible, deserve to be allowed to flourish in their worlds unmolested by us. Doesn't matter if we have a much more anthropocentric view, and we just worry about the ways in which what we do to nature affects other people, people living in different countries, people living, who will live in the years ahead. However we move into this space, it looks like there's a very large area in which we could all be making better decisions, where we could all be doing things which we generally see as good and right and fair and just. And just like if we changed subsidies, unfair subsidies and things like energy, we'd probably have a lot of leverage to move towards alternative forms of energy. Just as if we use information technology effectively to make big, complex issues more manageable. If we committed ourselves not just to talking about how moral we are, how ethical we are, and how much we'd like to live in a moral world, unfortunately our business leaders and our politicians have made it more or less impossible for us, and therefore the best thing to do is to throw in the towel and give up. If we made that same commitment, then we probably would be able to have a dramatic impact. I want to suggest we're far too early in this process of environmental rescue around the world to be stymied by areas where people disagree. Environmental ethics has largely been caricatured as the realm of eco-terrorists and animal rights and animal liberationists and people who are ungrounded and out of touch and elitist. There's a whole lot of reasons people have criticized the notion of thinking about nature from a moral perspective. But those aren't very compelling in the end. In the end, the choices are pretty stark. We may not agree with Peter Singer's argument that there's no obvious reason, there's no obvious moral boundary between species that should stop us from having sexual relationships with other animals. We may find that ridiculous, but then devoting the huge amount of attention that has been devoted to that issue, sort of a waste of time, because really it's a small squeaky wheel. What we all can agree on is that we should have clean water. Everybody in the world can pretty much agree that we should have clean water, that we should protect water, that we shouldn't allow the world to turn into that. We shouldn't be deterred and sidetracked by the things which move us into realms where there are no answers, where there are loud voices, but not real solutions to the question of sustainability. And we should focus on the areas in which we can make a considerable difference. I think that in the end, you know, there's a video I invite you to watch, but I've run out of time. However you cut into it these days, however you cut into the issue of the link between the good life, the fair life, the just life, and the way we interact with the world, the non-human world around us, however you cut into it, if your aspiration is sustainability, then you cannot escape the fact that at some point we have tough moral decisions to make. And these are not going to be easy. Moral life is not easy. Moral life is not handed to you. Moral life does not come without any requirement for sacrifice, for change, for commitment. Moral life is a tough life. It's like learning to be an accomplished musician or an artist. It's a tough life, but it's almost certainly as essential to the project of sustainability as rethinking some of our economic arrangements, rethinking some of our technological innovations, rethinking how we handle the cascade of science which is descending into our lives. So ethics, environmental ethics has gotten a bad name over the past 10 or 20 years. But I think it's a bad name because it's largely been caricatured. I think that it is impossible to promote sustainability without thinking through our behavior in terms of whether it is good, right, and just. Thank you. We have a couple minutes for questions if anybody has a question. Yes, sir.
We're not sure about us except that treating nature well and sustainability are important. But today I see a lot of problems on how to do it. And I could give you several examples that have just come up. That one is we want to build renewable solar power in the desert, and this is one of the Sierra Club platforms. On the other hand, the Sierra Club says, we found 3 sheep in this one canyon, you can't build there. We found 20 turtles here, we don't want them relocated, you can't build there. But this is one example. And then other examples is we have the Sierra Club on one side, and the other, the National Resource Defense Council, on another side. And it looks like there's a lot of, even once you accept that environmental ethics are important. The question is, how do you solve these problems? For this young audience, I can say, go back to Star Trek. How do you weigh the one against the man?
I mean, well, there's a couple of things there. One is, of course, that we have I think one of the sad things that's happened in our country is that the conservation community has often tried to slow down development has been with reference to the Endangered Species Act. And that is where it has been able to get the most leverage to slow down development and to say, this can't proceed because it puts this species in danger. And that does become often sort of a type of process which keeps people from seeing the bigger picture. So I think it's unfortunate that has become a popular tool for using, because you're exactly right. We need to look at the bigger picture, and we need to make informed decisions about where we're going to get more leverage for promoting sustainability. And it may be that moral choices would not be a problem if there was a certain sort of uncertainty and some sort of, something to be said about both sides of the equation. So there's no, that's what moral deliberation is all about, trying to say, okay, we need to move. It's not going to help the turtles very much if the temperature increases by a few more degrees in the desert. So we've got to think about alternative energy. And we have to be able to have that discussion. I think one of the things, I like the environmental groups here, Bill and so on, I'm sure they're fine. But they're really, in a lot of ways, they sort of miss the big issues. They're inviting us to make contributions, and they send us junk, backpacks and coffee cups and also glossy magazines, which probably take a larger toll on the environment than the contribution will ever offset. So you have to be very skeptical. They've gotten themselves into a place which what they do, they probably do well, but they're not looking at the big picture. And what we need to do is we need to develop a generation that isn't going to get locked into routines and patterns that ultimately are taking us nowhere. We've got to get people who can look at the big picture and say, I don't want to give you $25 and get it back. I want to solve the energy crisis. And so I think that, I'm not discouraging people from signing up with these organizations, but what I do want to point out is that they've gotten locked into routines which I think are no longer moving the agenda forward. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am. Probably from the Sierra Club, right? There's a very, very close linkage here and everywhere else between religion and ethics. I wasn't trying to suggest that it wasn't. What I was trying to suggest was that one of the dilemmas that Christianity introduced, which we continue to debate, is whether this world is sort of basically a corrupt place driven by power. That's a particular notion that really ultimately Thrasymachus was right, St. Augustine was right. This world is largely sort of a corrupt place, and you've got to focus on the next world. Your moral focus has to be. Now, Christianity is much more complex than that. And that's not, and as you know, that's as I tried to point out, that's not its only argument. That's just one of the arguments that it introduces, and it was quite powerful during the Middle Ages. So St. Augustine's City of God received an enormous amount of attention for a very long period of time. Now, around, you know, what basically happened was somewhere around the 12th, 13th century, people started to say, to ask, is the church really a source of moral leadership and guidance? Or is it reflecting the corruption that St. Augustine talked about? Because look at how these people live their lives. They own vast lands, they own a whole lot of stuff. They don't really obey the rules. They, you know, what we're seeing in the church is just that old argument that the rich and powerful do whatever they want. And they sort of tell the poor to pay for it all, to pay for their lifestyles. And so there was this challenge. Does that mean that everybody in the Christian church was sort of living the high life? Not at all. But it was a very distinct challenge because it was a very visible part of that world. And so the church had to readjust. It went through a reform movement. And it said, you know what? There's a certain amount of truth to this. We have given ourselves an awful lot of privileges. We are getting poor people to pay for these privileges. We forgot about poverty and about sacrifice. We've forgotten about these things. And there was what was called a Gregorian reform movement, which said, we've got to return to those values. Those are the values that are much more authentic, and we've lost them. So I didn't have time to go into it, but clearly, there's always been this tension. There continues to be this tension. People continue to sort of look with ambivalence towards organized religion. Is it our best bet for moral life? Or is it not our best bet? Is there something else? I don't think that it doesn't have a lot of competition here or anywhere else. So it isn't that there are obvious other moral leaders out there that we can turn to. But it's not obviously an uncontested source of moral authority. Yes, ma'am. I'm not sure if I understood the first part of your question, but I think, there's a famous essay by Len White Jr. called "The Historical Roots of Our Ecological Crisis," in which he argues that Christianity could have gone in one of two directions: the sort of stewards of the earth direction, which he links to Saint Francis, and the sort of be fruitful and multiply direction that Locke is most closely identified with, which one saying, go out there and turn those useless forests into pasture and farmland, and the other saying, no, respect this creation and the integrity of it. And so what he says is unfortunately, that image of transforming the forest cover into farmland, combined with sort of powerful technologies to allow us to do it at this rate where the damage took place before we fully appreciated what we were doing. So what can we do now? Well, I think there's several obvious things. One is it's really shocking that we don't introduce some consistent and serious environmental component into our educational system. I'm shocked that year after year we have students who are hearing this for the first time. This has been a mainstream, top of the agenda item for 20 years. And yet, it's not invested in our schools. Schools should be places where people are learning about this, from kindergarten all the way up. But instead, our schools sort of reinforce this disengagement. There are these sort of heavily paved areas with little green space where kids go in and they learn how to do rapid math so that they get high test scores, so the school gets an allocation of funds, and they don't really learn anything about nature. And I think that's a lost opportunity. Because I think what happens is they get to university and they say, they're shocked by the stories that they start to hear. I think that there's no reason why our government can't move more aggressively towards green procurement policies. You know, I was at I work quite a lot with the U.S. military, and the U.S. military has decided that because of its enormous power as a purchaser, it wants to try to move towards a green procurement policy and start to completely change how it purchases materials and how it uses them, how it operates them. Will it be able to do so? I don't know. But there's nothing that stops the government from mandating this across the board and so on. I think that the other thing is we have to get over these myths, these ridiculous myths that turning off your light switch is going to save the planet, that carrying a recycled bag is going to... A lot of this stuff ends up just sort of allowing us to purchase more and more goods. We end up in this endless purchasing frenzy to save the planet with recycled materials. So if recycled materials means you just buy more and more and more stuff, it's sort of missing the point. I think we need to start to take seriously the scale of the challenge that we're facing. And we have to start pretending that, you know, you can just, that there are easy little sort of 30-second solutions to the problem. And if we sort of do them, but we've got this sort of very sort of short-term, simple, 30-second fixes. I think all those books, 20 Ways to Save the Environment, sort of each one takes 30 seconds to do. I think they're sort of, we should sort of start shunning those. And we should start focusing on the fact that we're probably going to need to make deeper changes. I think a university should be leading. I think that campuses should be sustainable. I think students should demand it. And I think that these places should be obligated to adopt clean water in, clean water out, solar power, and so they should be models to the community that it's possible to do it. Instead, they sort of reaffirm that there's no real problem because we're insulated. But I think that what we're recognizing is we can displace the problems and we can project them into the future, but ultimately they're just going to come back on a larger scale, a less manageable scale. So we need to find ways to stop sort of putting the problems into another space or time and starting to recognize their scale. But I think there's lots of things we can do. Ultimately, 18 to 25-year-olds are the group of people who determine the decisions that businesses make about the commodities they're going to sell. And businesses mostly say, well, there's no demand for alternative energy. There's no demand for these things. I think that we should give every single person when they graduate a green startup package. I think that we should say, here's your startup package. Go buy, but you know, you can use it for better housing, for better energy, more efficient appliances, for public transportation, for whatever. And you should start off your life buying the right things, rather than saying, maybe when I'm 40 or 50, I'll buy the higher quality appliance, the more efficient, scooter, car, or whatever. We should give green retirement packages. We should say to people, when you're 65 or 70, whatever it is, and you retire, what you're going to get is you're going to get some support so that you can live the last 20 years of your life in an ecologically sound way. And we're going to help you do it. We're going to help, because we know we're going to have a lot of Americans who are retiring over the next 10 or 20 years. We should help them lead green lives. I think we should give people green startup packages, green retirement packages. We should give people green education. We should demand that our government procures using the best green principles that it can. I think that if we continue to pretend that if we walk around with a bag from Sierra Club, that's going to make a difference, then in 10 or 20 years we're all going to be terribly unhappy people. Any other questions? I mean, there's lots of more things. I think there's an endless set of things that we can do to make a difference. But I think it requires, I think that just like this generation, this young generation, best understands information technology, it best understands, it is most deeply in its bones, is an awareness of climate change and environmental change that earlier generations struggled to achieve. And we need to activate this. We need to give this next generation the authority to change things. Thank you very much.